tell you the truth. I'm afraid I'd have to say that after I've done and failed to do, I feel like less than I was meant to be. And what if I could fix myself? Maybe then I could get free. I could try to be somebody else who's much better off than me. But I need to remember this, that is when I'm at my weakest. I can clearly see he made the lady walk and the dumb talk, and he open-minded eyes to see that the sun rises on his dime. Yet he knows that deep is desperate need, and the world waits for his heart aches to realize the dream. I wonder what life
lonely world it hardly ever rains. I've never gone hungry, always felt safe. I got some money in my pocket, shoes on my feet.
Yeah. Jesus said the two greatest commandments are love God and love people. Love God comes back from the first commandment that God gave Moses. He said, you know, God is first, and you shall have no other gods before me. And Moses taught this in Deuteronomy 6 about how, you know, we're to write the words, the commandments of God, we're to literally write them on our very hearts. And we're to teach them. But isn't it amazing that these two commandments, love God, love people, he said everything hinges on that, because if you think about it, you can't do one without the other. God says this in his word in 1 John chapter 4. He says, you cannot love people who are created in my image. You can't love your brother. You can't love your sister in Christ if you don't love me. You see, we will never love people the way that God loves people until we fall in love completely with God. And I'm not talking about 99% falling in love with God. I'm talking about 100%, holding nothing back, making Him first, loving Him before everything. And it's until then will we really see people and love people as He loves them and as He's commanded the church to love people. Do you realize, this church, that you and I were created for a purpose? And the purpose is to bring glory and honor to God. Period. It's not to promote ourselves. It's not to make a name for ourselves, but it's to make much of God and to make a name for God. And until we truly fall in love with Him, we'll never do that. Until we truly put Him before everything and everybody, before our children, before our grandchildren, before our spouse, before our careers, before anything, He must be first. And we must love Him completely. And we must love Him with everything that we're composed of. And when we begin to love Him in that way, then we begin to see people in the way that God sees them, and we will begin to love them. And in there, the world will see a change. Jesus continues to teach this in John 13. He's spending some last moments with His disciples just prior to going to the cross. Jesus takes out the wash basin and the water and the towel, and He washes the disciples' feet. And He goes on to tell them that he's done this as an example of how they're to live and how they're to treat one another. But He continues on and He says, they're going to know you are my disciples by your love. By your love. How does the world know that we're followers of Christ? How does the world know that we're disciples of Christ? Not because we get up every Sunday morning and we drive over here. And certainly that plays a part of our witness, but there's a lot of folks that get up and drive to church every Sunday morning. They don't have a clue who Jesus Christ is. But the world's not going to know that we love God because of that. The world's not going to know we love God simply because we wear a t-shirt that says, I love Jesus on it. The world's not going to know that we love God because we have a little fish emblem on the back of our car, or maybe a bumper sticker that has a little catchy Christianese slogan. The world's not going to know that. But Jesus said the world will know we're disciples because of our love. Because of our love. And Jesus was radical, and Jesus said some crazy things that just flew in the face of culture. But He says, not only do you love, but you love your enemies. Ow. You bless those that persecute you. You bless those that hate you. You love and you share and you serve even the very ones that are trying to put you away. What would the world be like if the bride of Jesus Christ truly, really fell madly in love with Jesus Christ? and put Him first. And then we begin to see everybody else through the eyes of God as precious creations of God that Christ died for, regardless of where they live, regardless of the color of their skin, regardless of the religious beliefs and backgrounds, regardless of any of that, that we looked at them as created beings of God that Christ died for, that deserve to hear the gospel and receive love. That's the mission of the church. That's what we're supposed to be doing. It's not easy. And some people are hard to love. You might be thinking of somebody right now, gosh, that person's hard to love. But you know what? You might not be the easiest person to love either. I'm always thinking like, man, that guy's a bum. Man, how can you love him? And then I'm reminded of the scripture that I was dead in my trespasses. I was an enemy of God and I was a bum. Busting hell wide open. That there was nothing good about me. Until Christ stepped in and went to the cross and said, I love you. I have no idea where you're at in your walk with Christ this morning. I have no clue, but here's a few things I want to leave. Do you really love God? Do you really love God? With all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, do you really love Him? Answer that in your heart and in your head. Because when we get up here and we sing about God being indescribable and the song, oh, how I love Jesus because He first loved me, and we sing those songs and we pour out our affection, are we simply just mouthing the words, or do we really mean the things that we say? Because the proof is in our actions is when we leave this place and we go to our schools and we go to where we work and we go to the grocery store and we interact with people. That's when the truth comes out about how much we love God and how much we love people. You see, the love of God is a vertical relationship. It's between me and Him. It goes this way. And the love of people is a horizontal relationship. It goes this way. The people that I come in contact. And unless this love God is in order, the love people will never be right. All relationships hinge upon that. But isn't it funny that the love God and the love people, the vertical and the horizontal form cross? And the Bible says that while we were still sinners, God demonstrated His love for us. Jesus bridged the gap between the vertical and the horizontal by stretching out His body and stretching out His arms, offering a free gift of salvation to any of those that will put their faith and repent and be born again. The world is looking. The world offers up so many definitions of the word love that it's been polluted and perverted to the very form that nobody can even understand it is. But this is the definition: for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. You see, love is not something that God does. Love is who God is. Maybe this morning as you've come into this place and for whatever reason you've come in this place, maybe you've never felt loved. Maybe everybody that has come into your life that is supposed to love you has done nothing but maybe just the opposite. And maybe your view of love is not very high, and maybe you've just got this terrible opinion and you don't think you'll ever find love. You've never encountered the love of Jesus. And when the love of Jesus, when you allow the love of Jesus to break through the walls and to penetrate your heart, it changes everything. And so this morning, in just a few minutes, I'm going to ask Pastor to come and we're going to have a time of response. And this morning, if you've never experienced the deep, deep love of Jesus, If you've never experienced forgiveness for your sins, you know what? We're all broken people. But there's only one thing in my life that I have found that mends the broken heart, and that's the love of Christ. And if you've never experienced that, I invite you this morning to come and to ask and to seek and to pray. And maybe this morning you're hurting. Life happens. Life just happens. And sometimes it's a result of things that we do, and sometimes we have no control, but life happens. And sometimes we just need an extra little bit of love. I remember my grandmother, my dad's mom. She's a heavy-set lady, and she had the big arms, and I remember, you know, she had her arms hung down, and she always wore a dress, and she made her dress, and I don't think I ever remember a time that she didn't have an apron around her waist, because she was always in the kitchen, and she was always serving, and that was my grandma. And I remember she'd take those big arms, and she would hug me, and she would pull me in. That was like the safest place on the planet. It was like no other kind of love than grandma love. And I remember as a boy going to her house, that's the first thing. Man, I made a beeline to grandma just so she could hug me. And sometimes life happens, and sometimes we just need a hug. And we just need to wrap, you know, the arms of God, His love, to wrap around us and to hold us and to comfort us so we can feel that love. As great as my grandma loved me, it's nothing compared to the love of Christ. It's so much greater. And maybe life has happened to you this week, or maybe it's been a bad year, maybe it's been a bad month, maybe this morning it was just bad. And maybe this morning you just need to come and you just need to have God wrap His loving arms around you to love on you, because you're His child. And He's so much bigger than the problems and the things of this world. Maybe you just need to come and pray for somebody. Whatever it is, I'm gonna pray, and the pastor's gonna come up front, and that'll be your time to respond. Would you pray with me this morning? Heavenly Father, God, I thank you for your love. I thank you for, God, quite honestly, most of the time when I'm a knucklehead, you love me just the same. And Father, I know that you love each person that is here. They're precious in your sight. Precious enough that you would go to the cross, that you would endure the pain and suffering for our sins, Father God. That's how you demonstrated your love to us. And Father, as we're in this place, may we be focused on nothing other than what we need to do for you. Now, all the things that are going on around us, all those distractions, God, we just need you to filter out the noise. And may your Spirit move in this place. Father, I know what it's like to be hurting. I know what it's like to be searching. I know what it's like to be going from one thing to another, looking for answers. And Father, you are the answer. I pray this morning for those that are seeking and those that are searching and those that are out there, just seem like they're drowning in the world. Father, that they would drown in your grace this morning. This time is yours.